for laughter. We thank you for joy. Your kingdom is a kingdom of joy and delight and celebration. Because sin will be eliminated in all of its accusations and shame and frustrations and vitriol and hatred and meanness and anything. Everything that's not love is going to be eradicated. Anything that's not righteousness and holiness and purity and peace and all the fruits of the Spirit, they're gonna permeate the future life. They're gonna permeate eternity. And so that gives us something to look forward to. And so as we navigate this life, may we not be overcome by the cares of this world, but may our minds and our hearts be lifted to think of the future life, and that our citizenship is in heaven with you. So Lord, be with us as we as I teach and we talk just briefly, and as we pray, and hear our prayers for the sake and glory of Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. All right, so now just a simple question, and sometimes people wonder about this, and I thought I would just address it tonight. It's going to be very brief. And this is a question that some people have based on this verse, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 10. And we've started now, Wade. So 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 10, very famous section of 2 Corinthians. And it says, "For we," and this is believers, he's addressing the church, "we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ." So there is this seeming courtroom. Christ is sitting on this judgment seat. The idea is more Greek than it is Jewish at this particular section, because Corinth is certainly Roman and Greek in its orientations more than it is Israel. So this is a place of judgment. Christ is going to be seated there. He's the, you know, he's the reigning, ruling king. His judgment's going to stand. His word's going to be the final word. He's sitting there, and we're going to come before him, and it says we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ so that each one may receive what is due for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. And so the question is, are believers responsible for their sins in the future life based on this verse or the rest of the New Testament?
No.
And so Keith is saying no. So this is saying there's going to be some type of something.
Wood, straw, and stubble. Whether your works are of value for eternal purposes.
Yeah.
It's going back to Paul saying there's going to be the rewards that are eternal that are going to hold, and those that aren't.
Yeah. So there's a beauty in this. And like a lot of people, most of the people that I talk to or interact with this verse are terrified of this verse. They're afraid. Like, oh my goodness, well, am I going to think, you know, that I'm in, and then after the, you know, the separation of the sheep and the goats, and then I'm going to stand before Christ, and then I'm going to get rejudged, and then maybe I'm out? And it's like, no, that's actually not what this is talking about. So there is no longer any condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, i.e., there's no, you who have passed from death to life. Jesus has fully and completely and perfectly satisfied God for you who are in Jesus, you who put your faith in Jesus. And so the idea here is that when we stand before God, the idea is that I could actually say, as I have true faith in Jesus, reward me according to the righteousness that I have right now, which is only the righteousness of Jesus. So it might sound bold, and it might sound like, well, that's almost blasphemous. No. All you're doing is admitting, like, I've got nothing, but you've given me everything in Jesus. And that is what our eternal judgment is going to be based on, in that judicial courtroom of God in which he declares us not guilty. Because he looks upon us clothed with the perfect, completed righteousness of Christ.
That is just brilliant. I know it doesn't matter with my salvation. I'm saved. But when it says that what is due, whether it's for good or evil, I've always been taught that once I become a Christian and the things that I did, I use that for good. That's not that it would save me from, I wouldn't be saved anymore,
yeah.
But I just would have to give an account of, did I do what, you know, after he loved me and saved me, did I do the right things?
Yeah, and that's really what we're getting into now is reward.
Right.
So your salvation is a gracious, all of God gift. Okay. And then the reward here is the same. But what this is how did you appropriate the blessings that God gave you for the kingdom and purposes of Jesus? And so Keith brought up the verse of this, you know, there are going to be people that we admire here in this realm, this world, who appear as if they're doing so many great things for Jesus. But when they stand before the judgment seat of Christ, it's going to be exposed what they really did. Motive is going to play a huge part in that. Why did you do it? What did you really do? And then there's going to be people that we may pass over in our lives thinking they're just little old people, they just don't do a whole lot, you know, we don't even think about it, probably. And Jesus is going to reward them with so many, like we're going to, Paul talks about looking forward to his crown. Jesus talks about, you know, cities and or town people ruling over cities and those types of things. And everybody that's in the kingdom of heaven will have a fullness of heart. Everybody is just going to have just unending, overflowing joy. And the hard part is that some people are going to have more joy than other people. It's a weird thing. Think about glasses. You could have a full glass, completely full glass, but there could be a bigger glass, and it's full too. And as you use your gifts, your talents, your opportunities, the Lord, he will reward all of your efforts for his kingdom purposes and glory. And he will remove and strip away, burn away anything that did not walk in harmony with the glory and honor of Jesus. So there will be no honor for anything or anyone apart from Jesus. And therefore, do what?
We get to lay that crown.
Yeah, and even that, you know, we're just saying, well, that's because when we're standing there, we will recognize, like Paul, may have worked harder than all the rest, but it was by the grace of God who enabled me. So it's always going back. And so therefore, when we begin to understand these things, if you're getting the spirit understanding of this, you would want to say, Lord, be gracious to me and enable me to serve your kingdom purposes and the glory of Christ evermore. And that, I mean, and there's joy in that. There will be no, you won't miss out on anything. You know, y'all know this. You who serve the Lord, when you serve the Lord, you don't miss out on anything. It's just there is a satisfaction that comes from the Lord, that comes from His Spirit, that comes from His kindness, His grace, His mercy, and all the things that other people are chasing in the world. You're just like, oh, I got it in spades because God just pouring it out on me. Doesn't mean that we have an easy life. Doesn't mean we don't have any troubles. Doesn't mean, but the satisfaction of our souls, the contentment of our souls is found in Christ and God's love for us in Jesus.
It makes me think that, you know, as we are going to be changed to be like Him, that's the only way we're going to be able to receive all of that. Because now,
that's such a beautiful idea, and the fact that in the future life, you know, we talk about, well, we don't have any tears, we don't have any pain or anything like that. But He is actually going to enable us to receive the amount of blessing that He wants to give us, because we can't stand up under that. So if you think about in Romans, it talks about that the creation is held in suppression. Because if He didn't suppress the creation, we couldn't rule over it anymore because of our sinfulness. So it's going to be released into the fullness of its beauty and splendor. And we will then be exalted into the place that we were originally created to be in order to function in this super supernatural place. Is that how it's? I mean, you can let your mind and your imagination just run in those directions, and there will go in to the commencement that you'll have with what. And that's why the scripture says that no mind has conceived what God has for His people. Like, you can't even imagine how wonderful everything's going to be. Like, we don't have the capacity to dream that high. Our longings are too small. You know, that C.S. Lewis thing, we're just making mud pies because we don't know what a day at the beach is like. It's like that. It really is. And so, I was at the pool. There was this little boy. What was going on? We were talking about something. I can't remember what we were talking about, but he was talking about, and it may have been like he likes to eat, he was eating a snack, he was eating Cheetos or something like that, and I said, do you like Cheetos? He's like, oh, I love Cheetos. I said, do you think there's going to be Cheetos in heaven? He's like, I hope so. And I said, are you going to be there eating with me? So you just plant these little seeds, like, you like Cheetos? Are they going to be in heaven? Yes. Well, are you going to be in heaven? His grandmother was actually a friend of ours. Gospel-rich people, you know, just reinforcing, like, things I know that he's getting. And it's just sweet just to offer these sweet little things the kids and let their imagination see, God's going to have some Cheetos for me because he's that good. And when he gets to heaven to see some Cheetos, he's going to be wanting Jesus more than the Cheetos, but the Cheetos may be there too. All right, time to move on because I said it was short, but it wasn't so. Did you do that? All right. So, no condemnation in Christ, but there will be rewards in heaven for those who use the gifts and avail themselves of the grace of God that has been given to them. And so you can just ask for more and more. Alright, so we've got our prayer guide, Ephesians 5:19, all the way through 33, represented here, not necessarily every single verse, but mostly every verse. We're going to pray through those, and then we'll regroup in a minute and pray for our congregational needs. Let's go through the prayer. Okay. Heavenly Father, we are grateful that you have delivered us from the snare of the devil, that all those things that entrapped us and bound us, we've been set free from because of the work of Christ and his perfection and the completion of it. There's nothing left to do but to receive it and then to act upon it. And so, one of the EE questions, evangelism explosion questions, is, you know, we were standing before God and we were asking, why should I let you into my heaven? What would you say? And it's just solely by your sovereign grace and work on my behalf in Jesus. And that is it. I have no merit. But Lord, I believe that it is completely sufficient because you are the provider of that righteousness. So Lord, we, as we go to number one, we pray for God-honoring songs to govern our hearts and speech. And so that's Ephesians 5:19, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart. And there's a lot of praise music out there and this and that, and I don't want to cast the wrong idea. These things are basically theologically scriptural songs. So let your word and the music that is derived from the proper theology of your word stir us, move us, invigorate us, encourage us, make our hearts light and glad. You made us to sing. You made us to rejoice. And so as we interact with each other, may that joy and rejoicing and delight that comes from these songs govern not only how we feel, but govern what we say. And so we're grateful for the hymns of the church. We're grateful for the psalms. We're grateful that we sing and worship. We're thankful that we are very purposeful in God-honoring, Christ-exalting, doctrinally sound songs and music. So, Lord, may these things that you actually say in your word, we'll encourage each other with, we'll address one another, we'll just talk about these things. And may what we want to talk about and post on Facebook, social media, or whatever engagements we have with other people, may it be derived from what you called us to do from the Bible with the heart that you desire us to speak it with from the Bible. And when you get the glory for it, thanks be to Jesus' name.
Father, pray for a spirit of thanksgiving and everything. Ephesians 5:20 tells us to give thanks always for even in our redeemed state, we are prone to pride and selfishness. So forgive us of this sin. And Lord, you, the God who is all-powerful, ever-present, and all-knowing, you know that even the things that we do for you often come from an impure heart, so forgive me of this. And Lord, let me never forget. Unless I deny myself, take up my cross and follow you, I cannot do your good and perfect will, even with the Spirit who lives in me. For Lord, in my own strength I am prideful, and I confess this. And this prevents me from putting others for myself, so forgive me of this and change me. Help me to not think more of myself than I should, but put others before me. Help me to have a heart that desires to live at peace with all men as much as it depends on me. And Lord, let me never forget that when I do love as you have first loved me, there is joy and there is peace, for I am abiding in you. And Lord, you put until then, thank you for giving me the wonderful wife. A wife who is patient with me. And Lord, you know I try. But Lord, you give me a wife who loves me. And I know I'm not a lovable person. You've given me a wife who is wise. And as the proverb says, blessed is the man who has such. And you're blessed me with her. So Lord, I thank you for the great gift of Pam. And I pray, Lord, that you would help me to love her in a way that put a smile on your face. So I ask, Lord, that you would deal with your servant according to your loving kindness and teach me your statutes in a way that you, the potter, would mold the clay into what you desire me to be, such that I can love you, love my wife, love the body of Christ, and love all those in your creation. And Lord, there is much work that I'm asking you to do, for I know that I struggle. In Jesus' name.
Lord, I'll just close this with number 6 quickly and pray for the union of Christ and church that we manifest in marriage. It's 5:31-33. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This mystery is profound. And I am saying that it refers to Christ and the church. However, let each one of you love his wife as himself. And under what I see, that she respects her husband. And so we see Paul in this passage really talking about Christ in the church, and it looks like it's about husbands and wives, there's an application there, but in the end, it's like, well, the husband and the wife in the marriage are actually going to be a reflection of what's going to be going on with Christ in this church, where he will love her well, and she will respond appropriately. And so I pray that this high and holy calling can be manifested among the marriage partners. And this is